invited me to Prague, so it's beautiful city, it's a pleasure to be here. Just a little remark on the previous talks. We use NVIDIA and TensorFlow every day as we love them. Let me tell you that the brain consumes 20 to 40 watts. It is 4 to 5 orders of magnitude more efficient. There is a lot still to be learned from the brain. All right, so life sciences, when did they start? You can argue that as a science, they started shortly after the Renaissance, at the same time that Galileo built the first telescope. This gentleman in Holland built the first microscope with a magnification of 100 that allowed him to start looking at cells. He looked at sperm in particular, he got in trouble for that. That's another story. And today we have much better instruments for looking inside cells, and they look like this. This is a DNA sequencer produced by Illumina. And we have several of these on our own campus, for instance, and with such an instrument, you can sequence a human genome in a couple of hours. And the output looks like this. It's completely incomprehensible to the human eye. On this slide, you have the genome of the AIDS virus, which has 10,000 letters of DNA, ACGTs. It fits on one slide, and your genome looks exactly like that, except it's 3 billion letters. And so, of course, we need AI, machine learning, statistics, etc., to make sense of this data. And this is just one example of many other types of omic data and other types of data that we're getting in the life sciences. When did deep learning start? I would argue it started here with shadow learning, which is linear regression to me, Gauss and other. And if you look at this slide, what I tell my students is that everything about machine learning is already in this slide. You have data, you're trying to make sense of data, you come up with a model, it has parameters, you have to feed the model to the data, you can use the model for prediction, you can compare different models, etc., etc. So everything about machine learning, I believe, is essentially contained in this slide. And what we're doing today is just, in many ways, it's linear regression and steroids, because of course we're trying to feed surfaces, curves that are not linear, and that are very often in high-dimensional spaces. If you're dealing with images, it's not uncommon to have 1 billion images of size 1 million. So that is really the change that has taken place. And as you know, using deep learning, I'm not going to define deep learning, but basically using deep learning methods today on many specific problems, in particular in computer vision, for instance, we're getting performance that is better than humans. This is ImageNet, and humans are about 5% error rate, and now we're at 4.5% or something like that. So I assume that you're all familiar with this, and what we're going to do now is to apply these techniques to some biological data. I'm just going to show you some examples from my own lab, but there is much more out there, of course. Before I got a little piece of theory, when you're dealing with images or vectors of fixed size, you can use feed-forward neural networks. But in biology and other sciences, very often we have data that is variable in sizes, for instance, DNA sequences, protein sequences. You have small molecules, chemical molecules, right? They come to you with a graphical structure, a graph, a sequence, etc. And they are variable in size. So if you want to deal with these kinds of objects, you have to use recurrent or recursive neural networks. And to do that, to simplify things, I'm going to use two kinds of techniques that I call the inner and the outer approach. In the inner approach, you're using your neural networks to crawl inside the data graphs. So I'll give you an example from a sequence. If you have an HMM, you have your neural networks that are crawling inside the HMM. In the outer approach, you're building your neural networks in a direction that is perpendicular to the structures. So on sequences, what does this mean? Imagine you have sequences, you model them with an HMM, then you can put a neural network on the transition here, and you can share it at these two positions. That's why the approach is recursive. And then you can have a second neural network on the emissions, so that this model can be represented with two recursive neural networks, one for the transition shared at all the time steps, and one for the emissions. So it looks something like that, right? So that's the inner approach. If you want to do an outer approach on sequences, you have your sequence here, and then you have a neural network that looks maybe at time t and its two neighbors, for example, repeated at each position. You can have weight sharing. They produce a certain vector output, and then again you do it again. You have a second neural network here, maybe a slightly different architecture. This neural network, of course, will look at a larger window on the input sequence, etc., and you keep stacking them on top. So that's the outer approach. And of course, you can combine them recursively, etc. You can do more complicated things. But I think, as a starting point, it's useful to have this distinction between inner and outer. So let's apply them to small molecules. You have small molecules in organic chemistries. They typically come to you as a graph. You want to predict physical, chemical, biological properties of these molecules. The nice thing is that you can represent molecules in many different ways. You are familiar with these kinds of graphs, but you can also represent them like strings. These are called smile strings. It's very easy to convert one representation to this representation. You can represent them as fingerprints. These are long binary vectors, in this case fixed length, mostly zero, very sparse, and you put a one when a certain particular feature is present in the molecule or not, and there is different basis of features. I won't go into the details. You can represent them as 3D objects, which is what they are. For instance, you could give the XYZ coordinates of the nuclei of the atoms in this molecule. So this is the only representation that is of fixed length, vectors of fixed length. All the others are variable and require recursive neural networks. So suppose you want to apply an inner approach to this graph. The first problem you have is that the edges are not oriented, so you have to choose an orientation. And in addition, sometimes you have the cycles, you have a benzene ring, for instance, and the graph has to be a cyclic, has to be a directed acyclic graph so that you can propagate the neural networks and then do the band propagation. So one solution for that is to take all possible orientations. So that's the solution we use in this case. You can see the molecule is here. I repeat it as many times as there are nodes. In each copy, I take one node as the sink, the gray node, and then I orient all the edges towards that node. So now I get directed acyclic graph. I have neural networks that are crawling these molecules from the source nodes towards the sink nodes. They produce even vectors, which are then combined and passed to a final feedforward neural network, which concludes whatever prediction you're interested in. In this case, it was solubility, but it can be anything, toxicity, etc., and that works quite well. You want to do an outer approach on molecules. This has been done, was presented at least by this group. What you do then is you have the molecule in the plane, and you see you're building this neural network perpendicular to the molecules, and you have at the first level neural networks that are looking at one atom and maybe its two neighbors, etc., etc., right? And it's not that one approach is better than the other. Both are useful. It depends on a lot of other considerations. And we're putting out two libraries on GitHub that can allow you to implement the inner approach or the outer approach to chemoinformatics applications. Another application in biochemistry is the prediction of chemical reactions. It's a very complex problem. So you can use different approaches. We tried with a rule-based system, which works reasonably well, but we're now doing a deep learning approach. And the idea there is that if you look at a chemical reaction like this, the bromination of an alkene, basically, the way chemists think of it is just electrons moving from rich sources to sinks, to areas that are poor in electrons. In this case, you have multiple ops. In this case, HBr gives you H plus Br minus, and then the Br minus attacks this atom and produces the brominated compound, right? So basically, you have to find sources and sinks of electrons, and this is easy. It's just parsing the molecules. You have rules for finding sources and sinks. You may have, let's say, 10 sources and 10 sinks in your reactors. That gives you 100 source-sink combination. So you have to rank them, and this is a machine learning problem. This is what Google does when you search things on the web. And so we do that by using a Siamese architecture, deep network. With two copies of the network here, we present a source and a sink pair on each side, and the output has to tell you whether the source sink pair on the right is more favorable than the one on the left. And this works quite well. We are right now at the level of graduate student in chemistry, and hopefully we'll get to the level of human experts. The main problem is the data is getting the right training data for training systems. Other applications, of course, many applications to DNA. You can predict the effect of mutations. You can try to find in certain regions around genes interesting control regions in promoters of genes, finding binding sites for transcription factors and things of that sort. I don't have time to talk to you about that. Let me say a few things about protein structure prediction, which is a very important problem. So your genes and your DNA, you have roughly 20,000 genes. They are coding for proteins. And proteins are sequences made of amino acids. There is 20 natural amino acids. And these sequences typically have length of a few hundred, let's say 500, typical length for a protein. And they fold up in very complex 3D structures which determine their function, which other proteins they bind to, or they may bind to DNA, feeding back onto DNA to control gene expression, etc., or bind to small molecules, right? So you want to predict the structure of these molecules, these very large molecules, these thousands of atoms. And there are many sub-problems into this. One problem is to predict secondary structure, which is the location of these things. These are called alpha helices that recur all the time in proteins, you know, one here. You have another thing called beta strands, which are these flat arrows here, with hydrogen bonding between the different strands. And then you have things in between called coils. So that's the secondary structure prediction problem. Then you want to go to 3D structure, which may be predicting the XYZ coordinates of the atoms on the backbone of the protein, connecting all the amino acids. And you can even go beyond that to a full 3D model where you predict also the XYZ coordinates of all the other atoms in the amino acid that are sitting on the sides of the backbone. You can even go to quaternary structure where you have two protein chains that are combining together to form a complex and so on. So very complex problem, but the fundamental thing is that the structure of the protein is invariant under translation and rotation. So you cannot just do a deep network, give it the sequence and speed out like with the coordinates, because the coordinates depend on translation and rotation, whereas the structure does not. So to solve this problem, we break up the problem in steps. We start from the protein sequence. We predict a number of features, including secondary structure. And then we predict this representation here, which is translation and rotation invariant, which is called the contact map. It's one of them, there is several. But the contact map is basically a binary matrix, a very sparse matrix, where you put the protein on the X and Y axis, and you put a one here, if and only if, letter I and letter J, amino acid I and J, are close to each other in the 3D structure when the protein folds. Right? Close to each other, you can define it in technical, it's that the carbon alphas of the two amino acids are within 8 angstroms, for instance. And so you get this binary matrix, it's symmetric, it's very sparse, and of course, what is difficult is to predict this corner here where you have long-range contacts. Letters that are far away in the sequence that ends up to be close to each other in space, right? And then from here, you want to recover the XYZ coordinates of the structure. So the third step, good news, is essentially solved. It's solved a while ago. It's not machine learning, it's instant geometry. If you give me a good contact map, I can give you the structure up to mirror images, which is not a big problem. So let's look at the first step, prediction of secondary structure. It's essentially a translation problem, if you want to think in terms of languages. You have an input that is over a 20-letter alphabet. You want an output that is over a 3-letter alphabet, alpha helix beta strand of coil. We used so this is the inner approach. You can see here a bidirectional input-output HMM. If you think in terms of Bayesian networks or graphical models, you refactor this using recursive neural networks. You get three neural networks, one for the output, one for the backward chain, one for the forward chain. If you unfold it, it looks something like that. Everything is acyclic, you can backpropagate gradients, etc., and you can use that for training. To summarize the improvement in performance over the last 30 or 40 years, it started with Chu and Fassman around 78, which came up essentially with very basic rules and achieved 60% correct prediction on secondary structure prediction. and through a number of, this is the first application actually of neural networks to computational biology that I'm aware of, Kian and Sinowski in 88. They got 64%, so some improvement. And the latest results we have are about 95% correct prediction, which we think cannot be improved by much because, you know, there is noise in the data, there are proteins that do not fall spontaneously, there are proteins that need other proteins in order to fall, called chaperones, etc. So there is some complexity in the data that make us quite confident that you cannot get to 100%, it would be meaningless. So the second problem is solved. The first problem, sorry, and the third problems are solved. What about this one? Well, this one is the most difficult problem in the pipeline. What we do again is to apply the inner approach, same thing but generalized to two dimensions. So you have an input plane, an output plane, and then you have four even planes, which are lattices, and you propagate things in each lattice towards one of the four cardinal quarters, southeast, southwest, etc. So if you look in one column, it looks like this, the output at position ij, which is a classification, is there a contact or not, is a function of four even variables in the four even plane and a function of the input ij, which could be the window around the amino acid I, the window around the amino acid j, plus secondary structure around the I and secondary structure around j, etc. A few other things that I don't have time to put through it. You refactor it as neural networks, you get five neural networks, one for the output, four for the lateral propagations in the hidden planes, and so that's how it is. You want to do an outer approach on contact map prediction, we did that. And the idea there is think of your contact map this year, how we are going to grow neural network orthogonally to the contact map. And imagine that you are folding the protein in time. At each step, you get a slightly better contact map, basically, right? So that's the architecture we're using. And the good news is that on benchmark tests that were done, for instance, a few years ago, these deep learning methods were getting the top two slots in this standard benchmark comparison. The bad news is that the quality, the prediction is still low, in particular in the corner of the contact map where things are very interesting, the long range rare contacts, we get about 20% accuracy. And of course, you would like to get to at least 50 to get reliable prediction of protein structures. We have application to circadian rhythms, but I don't have time to go into that. I'll be happy to take questions. Let me finish with a couple of simple applications of deep learning to biomedical imaging. There, of course, you can use convolutional neural networks, etc. So this is an example where we're looking at mammograms, you know, x-rays of breasts, which are taken to detect cancer. Of course, you can look for cancer, but we look for something else here. You can see blood vessels. And you can also look at how much calcification there is on those blood vessels. You can even do regression and try to estimate the total amount of calcification in breasts. And high levels of calcification are a potential sign of blood disease. So as a byproduct of getting screened for breast cancer, you can also get screened for high risk of RBCs. And if there is a high level of calcification that is found, you could go and undergo additional tests. This is another example of a microfluidic system that is being developed on my campus where biologists are capable of drawing blood vessels in very small chambers, and then they can inject cancer cells, they can inject drugs, and look at the effects, the interactions between cancer, vasculature, and drugs. And this can be done in fairly high-throughput fashion. You can generate thousands of such images in these wells. In a few hours, and it's very tedious for humans to look at this picture and try to decide if the vasculature as it's expanded, decreases, etc., as a consequence of cancer. You can see the blue cells here are the cancer cells that are in the system, or as a result of drugs, etc. So again, we apply convolutional neural networks to these images to classify them in these different categories. This is an example of detection of metastasis in the spine. Most cancers, when they metastasize, they tend to go to the spine. And so it's very important to be able to detect reliably detect cancer that is in the spine. So again, just convolutional neural networks. I don't know, each application has you know, a number of details, but you get the idea if you are familiar with convolutional neural networks. And the last one is in colonoscopy, you want to detect polyps, you want to classify them in premalignant, malignant, etc. And so again, we use convolutional neural network to detect these polyps. Now, when you do a colonoscopy, the size of your colon, the area, is about the size of a tennis court. And the colonoscopy takes, you know, 4 or 5 minutes. So it's very hard for a doctor to examine every little corner. And so I think these methods will be useful for that. Now, colonoscopy is a video, and you may ask, you're doing this on images, how are you going to do it in video? Well, training takes time. So it may take several days, even on GPUs. But once the systems are trained, the neural network takes 10 milliseconds or less to produce the production, to produce the prediction. So even if we have video, you can very comfortably run, you know, do prediction on 20 frames, and that's plenty. And if you have, you can even use a correlation between frames to strengthen your inference that there is a polyp in a particular region or not. And I have videos of this, but it's a little bit gross, so I'm not sure. Thank you very much.
Thank you very much, Pierre. And now we have time for questions. Over there. Do we have more questions? Thank you very much for the talk. I have a more technical question regarding the last application you mentioned, this real-time detection. So, yes, you mentioned really impressive latency of 10 milliseconds is 100 frames per second, right? So how huge is your network that you do real-time detection, right? Of those polyps?
It's a, you know, it's a moderate size convolutional neural network.
And precision is sufficient for you?
Yes. And we don't do 100 frames, we don't need 100 frames.
But latency is just 10 milliseconds.
Yeah, it's about 10 milliseconds.
Thank you. And how huge was your training data set? I'm just curious about this.
That's a very good question. So the starting data sets, the one we have now, we have 6,000 images of polyps and 6,000 images of, you know, non-polyps. But we have in place a system for aggregating data and creating bigger data sets. But that's what we have as a starting point.
So did you pre-train your... I'm just really impressed with the performance and the...
So we did the usual tricks. We did, you know, surgery on Google Net or AlexNet and things like that, and we train our own. So you get comparable things either way. So we did all of those. I can send you, you know, the paper is not, it's about to be submitted, I can send you. And just retrain the top, we design our own architecture, we compare them, etc.
One last question.
Thank you very much for the nice survey. And I think just interesting, in comparison between the machine learning approach and the traditional approach, which I think is about minimizing global minimization of some molecular mechanic potential, does it mean that currently the traditional approach lags behind the machine learning?
Well, I mean, ideally, in chemistry, you would like to derive everything from your equation, right? That is completely unfeasible, even on the best supercomputers. I mean, you can handle system as soon as you have. 20 atoms or complex reactions, you cannot do them from first principle. And you cannot do them even from molecular dynamics approximations. It's just not feasible. So I think machine learning is a way.